Wise words are like seeds. The more you scatter them, the more they will grow into infinite gardens of knowledge. May I now call upon the stage student manager Ajinkya Bonde to introduce our guest.
Good afternoon to all the dignitaries on and off the dais. I, Ajinkya Bonde, student manager, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, takes an immense pleasure to welcome our guest, Ms. Samruddhi Mulye today. Ms. Samruddhi Mulye holds 15 years of vast experience in human resources. She has done postgraduate diploma in business administration, specializing in human resource from Mitibai College, Mumbai, and is certified black belt Lean Sigma champion. Her specialties lies in performance management, organization transformation and development, and capacity building. Currently, ma'am is working with Intellecap Advisory Services Private Limited as head human capital. Prior to this, she worked in Avishkar Venture Management Service, Plug HR, Reliance Business Solutions and Services, Spanco Telesystem, and Royal Bank of Scotland. Ma'am, may I now request you to please enlighten us with your words of wisdom. Ma'am, the podium is all yours.
No, that's okay. It's okay? Yeah, okay. Sorry, and especially when you're on stage and addressing a set of people and you can see whether the concentration levels are there or not. But good, I'm happy to see and hear his experience. So, well, I won't talk much about me. Let me just introduce you to the sector that I am come from and what that sector really does. Before we really move into that, how many of you aspirants in HR professionals? Management. So what does all this mean? Where is it going? What do you think is the relevance of HR? I mean, is an HR now only an administrator in businesses? What kind of role does HR play? So let me just share with you my experience. My introduction to HR happened by accident. I mean, I had not planned to be in HR at all. It just started. I was out, fresh out of college, and I wanted to experience how the working life really is. And this goes 17 years back when I had no professional qualification. You guys have sound foundation on how organization works and what organizational principles are. I didn't even know that. So I think a lot that I have built is through experience, and I want to share that experience with all of you. It's after spending several years in HR, I decided to take a formal education in HR. So I really went the reverse way compared to how everybody else really goes. So let's look at how businesses are shaped today. Okay? I think today the HR has evolved from being an administrator to a business partner. So you heard it right. It is called a business partner, which means that you are partnering with the business and you have equal performance targets to ensure that your business delivers, which means you need to understand your business very well. It cannot happen that you don't know what your business does, you don't know what your top line is, You don't know what your PATs and EBITDAs are. You have to be a numbers person yourself. So this is very important because otherwise you've lost the game. You need to ensure that you reserve that seat in the boardrooms that's meant for the people officer, representing the people of the organization who are contributing towards the business. So what exactly does a business partner mean? So what are those things that one really needs to do to ensure that your business is delivering? So can we hear some words coming across? What do you think does the HR professional have to do to ensure? Throw in just 2-3 words. Let's see if we are, you know, absolutely in sync on what do we have to do. What's our target? Anyone, all the HR people or non-HR also, yes, please tell me. As a change agent, okay. Let's come to that on where that will be applicable. Any other words? Right.
Accordingly, then we can do
communicating between different departments. Right. Okay. Taken on board. We'll come again. We'll talk about it. What else? This side is silent. That side is silent. No HR people here?
Critical decision making.
Critical decision making. Right. Okay.
Succession planning.
Okay. Succession planning. See how the words are coming out now. Aligned to?
Alignment of objectives.
Objective setting. Solving, resolving conflicts. Very good. Sorry? Finance? Grievance. Did I hear grievance? Grievance management, okay. We jump straight to the grievance, huh? Okay. Sorry? Competency mapping. Very good. Strategic partner. I'll catch you in some time. And?
Manpower planning.
Good.
Legal and compliance.
Very nice. Absolutely critical. Very good. Training and development. I heard that. Absolutely important. Okay, so now let's do one thing. I think that discussion is now going to be really seamless. So let's just come and take one thing at a time. So I think all of you all have brought in the critical points that we are talking about when it comes to making your performance deliver. The most important aspect that an HR professional needs to do in the institution, like he said first, is objective alignment. Objective setting. It is very important for you to be a partner. So whether you're an HR partner, you're a finance partner, or any other function partner, it is very important that your individual and your collective team goals are aligning to the overall company objectives. Unless that is done, then it's futile. You're just a function who's doing administrative jobs. So let's say, for example, the vision of my company is by 2020, we have to ensure that we are there in 5 continents. We have employed 5,000 companies or employees, and we have acquired at least, about 20 companies in the same space. Let's say that's the broad vision. That vision needs to trickle down and broken down. So how am I going to adopt it to my function? What do I have to do to go to that level? I have to ensure that my talent acquisition processes are so crisp that I'm hiring the right kind of talent and competency that is needed for my business to deliver. That's the first step, right? That's where one begins. The kind of people who come into the organization are the ones who define. What comes next is what she said about is change management or culture imbibition of those people. You have to make those people settle in your culture. What kind of a culture do we have? We have an entrepreneurial culture. We are not micromanagers. We let employees, right from analyst to an associate director level, absolutely free to work the way they want to. They literally fly. I mean, you have an idea, you have a business idea, go for it. We are not going to stop you because you're an associate. So that culture, imbibition and development is very important. What are the other things? Because when we spoke about training and development and compensation and benefits, come much at a later stage. So I think over a period of time, our businesses and the people who want to be in these businesses have evolved to a level where now most of us don't really want to be, you know, I mean, it's a very critical factor. I don't want to really misguide you that money is not that important. Money is. But I think the purpose of work and the meaning of work that you do has taken larger prominence in our lives now. Is the work I do very meaningful? Do I wind up my day feeling very happy about the work I do? And that's what I think is the defining purpose when you're working on your overall talent strategy. So for that instance, in my institution where I work, we wouldn't really hire people who are gunning for salaries. I mean, like, really offbeat it might look like, we have people taking salary cuts to join us. Not that you can't afford to pay, one needs to see the passion you have to work. So now that brings to me, I should talk to you about the company that I am associated with, the institution. So Avishkar Venture Management Services and Intellecap Advisory are a part of the same group company. What does Avishkar do? So Avishkar is India's first pioneer impact focus fund that looks at investing in the companies that are working towards the development of bottom of economic pyramid. So what is the market for us is the last layer in the pyramid, which is the absolutely rural or the other side of India where you have most of the underprivileged working. You have people who have difficult to meet their day-to-day means. That's the sector we work in. So we invest in companies that are working on products, projects, services, manufacturing, but meant to impact the bottom of economic pyramid. Intellecap Advisory is an advisory firm, which the name itself says. It works into strategy consulting and investment banking. Again, the market focus is bottom of economic pyramid. As difficult it might sound, it is a complete for-profit venture. What kind of work do we do? So we have invested in several companies that make huge difference in the livelihoods of the people staying in rural India. For example, we made an investment in a company that works on art, creating. It's a company that is established in Rajasthan, where it makes livelihoods through creating the various art forms in terms of clothes, statues, etc., the traditional stuff that you see kept in the houses that really comes from that place, Rajasthan. We've invested in that company. Absolutely difficult place, but that's generated jobs to almost 1.5 lakh people. They're employed now. They get their salaries, they get their wages, they get their daily, monthly salaries, their families are now fed. So this is the kind of impact we create outside. So what's the role of HR in a company like this? It looks like a completely finance-driven company, right? Private equity, strategy consulting, investment banking, which is completely transaction advisory, but HR has a huge role to play because it's a very different niche industry. It's not known as yet. We've been here for 2 decades. It's now that people have started talking about it because of Make in India initiatives, Swachh Bharat initiatives. And that's where now the focus has moved to how to develop the bottom of the economic pyramid to push them up. And if you look at statistics, that pyramid has now changed into a diamond. How has that got changed to a diamond is a significant percentage of people in the bottom of an economic pyramid have moved a level up. And the significant jump is almost about 38%, which has changed the pyramid to a diamond. So if you see, you have a very little, I mean, in terms of numbers, it's a huge percentage, but a small proportion to change. As a nation, you will be catapulted into a very different phase. You will no longer supposed to be called a developing economy or developing nation. Now, coming back to the HR, please. So what really is required in a place like the social and development piece is you have to convince people a lot about your vision. You're different. You're not in a mainstream company. You're not an IT, or you're not a technology, you're not a mobile or automation company or a manufacturing sector. You're a development sector. So does the development sector really have interesting careers? Does it really give you the kind of money? Because obviously all of us here are to earn money. You can't really work without having salaries. You have families to feed. So yes, it is extremely interesting sector. It is a developing sector. The amount of jobs and livelihoods it can create across all stages of, you know, the financial well-being of any person. To date, we have now employed 3,000 employees. We are 3,000 employees strong. In next 5 years, we'll cross the mark of 5,000 employees. We have the biggest microfinance sector in the entity, which operates out of Calcutta, West Bengal. So financial inclusion is playing a very significant role in the country now. I'm sure by virtue of your curriculum, you're learning a lot about how the economy of your nation is changing. What does financial inclusion mean? What does fintech mean? What does edutech mean? What does meditech mean? You see how you're evolving in a small-time village where there is no access to healthcare, you're still able to reach to that sick lady or a sick old man using your meditech technology to be able to treat that guy. Farming, agriculture, which is core to your country, you are able to develop that and bring to a next level by running an organization that is an advisory into farming. How to produce better yield? How to increase or multiply your yield? So the sector is widening every day. The dynamics in this sector are changing every day. This is becoming a global discussion in the US, in the UK. There are several forums that have been formed. Intellecap Avishkar has the pride and privilege to be a part of all global forums and discussions on development needed in India or the other developing countries, that is Africa or the Southeast Asian countries, which still need a significant jump or a push. So what kind of careers do we have in this sector? Obviously, this is a sector specific, it's financial services. So all you finance guys, there is tremendous opportunity. Unless you all have made up your mind that you want to typically do the finance role, think about diversion on financial inclusion, think about microfinance, think about how you can build an entrepreneurial culture yourself after you're out from this institution. There's lots and lots and lots to do. It just does not have to be a corporate job. It does not have to be a 9-to-5 job. You have to start thinking differently to address unique problems that are there. For all the other operations management people, there is tremendous opportunity, seamless opportunity to bring all of this together. How are you going to run these institution companies which are headquartered somewhere in Bombay, Delhi, to reach to the rural side of India? That operations is an extremely difficult task, but extremely fulfilling because there's no ready-made solution to it. Let me tell you, there is no ready-made framework. There are no papers available. There are no solutions available. You are the one who are creating solutions. You are the one who is referred to as a solution creator. So it's extremely fulfilling to be a part of an ecosystem that is really developing your most crucial layer that defines the future of this country. And for HR, it's even tougher. Why is it tougher is because, again, like I said, to drive your company objectives, to explain to the kind of work you do. I don't do any job less than a marketing person. So be it onboarding an associate to a director level person from a mainstream industry takes the same amount of effort. To explain what kind of work the institution does, what is the outcome of that institution, how can you create a difference? Everyone who comes in this space, I'm not saying that these two companies are the only companies in this space. We are the ones who are there holistically, but there are people who are working in this space. There's a Leapfrog, there's a Low Capital, there's an Acumen Fund. There are a lot of not-for-profit institutions also working towards it. But what is it that will really trigger the entire corporate or mainstream talent to divert their attention and bring their skill sets to this sector is very critical from an HR point of view. Second, like somebody really said about capacity building, again, a very critical point and comes next to talent acquisition. You have to build that capacity to be able to deal with these situations. Let me tell you, in this space, no situation is defined. You do not know what problems are going to come in tomorrow. You have no clue of how you have to handle it. Like someone spoke about grievance management. You have, you know, all these things are there everywhere. But I think an institution challenge is very different from each other. You can't really say what kind of grievance you get, but these are like part and parcels of any profession. So grievance needs to be handled by the direct managers as well. So not really necessary that HR needs to go into it. So let's just touch upon some topics that really will transform the business and take it to next level. After that, I think we should keep it a little interactive to know what questions you have and if I can really address them. So what is it that really takes, what does HR need to do to take business to the next level? So are there any pointers that will come? I mean, not the same names that we said, but let's talk about tomorrow. You set yourself out of this institution, join a company. A company is a startup, a company is an old-timer company, a big institution, wherever, whatever is of interest to you. So if you have to take the institution to the next level, what is your assessment? What's the next era look like? What's the future of HR?
I'm adopting new technologies.
Absolutely. That was going to be my first point, speed and data. It's extremely critical. If you've seen the trend of 2015 for HR has been extremely an analytics year. Data is extremely important and so is technology. How does technology make life easier? So I'm just explaining to you that we are in a place where it is so difficult to reach out. How do you reach out to your employees who are working in these branches? Technology. You need to have that seamless technology which is able to communicate to people. That communication using technology can be for training and development. It can be employee engagement. It can be performance evaluation. There are a lot of things that technology is changing now. For that matter, you can develop an intranet for yourself that really keeps the stickiness on. I mean, you're constantly conversing with your team member who's no longer sitting next to your cubicle. He's somewhere else. But your conversation on projects, non-projects, fun, whatever you want to talk is on your intranet. You don't have to use your Facebook or the other, social platforms. You can have your own system, your own technology that can be really used to engage the team members with each other. Data is the next point because I'm just picking up from the technology point. I don't think the HR should actually be even speaking without data. Data is so critical. Now, what do we make out of this word data? It's such an open and ambiguous word. Data is for everything, right from what is the trend outside when it comes to talent acquisition? What is the trend in other geographies? That data will help you define what kind of talent you want to get into the institution. Do I need a global talent for a role? Do I need a talent that is just local? What kind of skill set do I need? How much of the skill set is available in which geography? How does that change? So you need to have, so you can't really have subjective decisions taken. That decision that has been made has to be made basis the data and the analysis that it really shows you. So that's extremely critical that you have technology at the back of your hand and you have the data sitting straight right in front of you. So let me tell you, all you HR professionals, 10 years, 15 years down the line, once you take up senior positions in the companies and lead the companies, lead the people practice of the companies, the entry to the boardroom is only because of data. You have to be very sharp about your conversations. It can't be subjective conversations of, I heard this is in the market, or I heard that is not working out well. It has to be completely, completely data driven. Back it up with complete data, graphs. And that's how things will evolve for HR. So that's a very good point. What is the other point? What do you think is going to come up in HR next?
Culture.
Absolutely important. What kind of culture do you think should be there?
I think an organization builds its culture from its values and beliefs that it is coming from. It's from
Correct. So I think I'll just take on board your point, but I'll just elaborate when he mentioned culture. I thought for a moment on what really do we want from that new person who joins us. I think it is a very important part that the HR defines the culture very crisply and is very closely aligned to the vision and values of the company. So let's pick up the same example of our vision. We're saying by 2020, we want to be in 5 continents, employing minimum of 5,000 employees. So what does it need for me? So if I'm saying I want to be in 5 continents, I want to take this business to 5 continents, of which we are already in 2. We are already in Africa. We are already here in India, which means there's a lot of work left. What do I have to look at? I need a talent that is extremely entrepreneurial. That's my culture. I will not have an employee who is kind of, you know, waiting for direction from the supervisors on how to work next, what work to do. I need someone who is a quick thinker, who's able to innovate, who's able to invent, who's able to think. It's no longer a time for people to just sit and work. You have to keep innovating in the place that you are. And that's the culture that probably I want to build in an institution. There are other organizations who have different ways of working. That's how the culture is defined. So HR plays a very critical role from a culture point of view. If there is culture mismatch, if there's a culture mismatch and I don't agree with working the way the organization works, the engagement will never work. That is bare basic. Whether I have any engagement practices, whether I'm doing any training or development, whether I'm giving enough opportunity to the employee is actually secondary. It's like, you know, your family. If you have a discord in your family, what happens? You don't like it, right? You're uncomfortable when you're back home. You are constantly having those fights. But when you are culturally aligned and everybody in the family follows the same value system, you are together. That is the same principle that works. There is no other dynamic to it. It's not a rocket science. You have to ensure that everyone who comes in is able to understand the culture that you're driving and be comfortable in that culture. The moment you see discomfort, you must be alarmed to see that things are not going to settle. Very, very important, very basic. What else? Are any thoughts coming to your mind? This side and this side is... Sorry? Adapting to change, yes. I think HR a lot of time has to play a role of change manager. And I think in today's world, if I can just take from his point and tell you where the change management role really comes from is the mergers and acquisitions scene that we have in the business. So acquisitions or merging is a part of your business expansion plan. Could be sitting in someone's strategy at one point of time, and it probably needs to move to the next level because if you have a steep target, you have no choice, you have to look at these situations. But when you're talking about mergers and acquisition, it brings the devil out in HR. Boss, you really, really have 2 different cultures either getting acquired or merged. It can't be a bigger challenge for HR. And especially if you see that your company's culture is starkly different from the other. So that amalgamation is extremely important. The programs, the initiatives, the relationships you run with a new set of people when you are in a situation like this is very, very critical. There is nobody in the organization, neither your CEO, CFO, chairman, whoever it is, will be able to do anything unless HR plays the role of a change manager. Transition will happen only if the HR facilitates it. Because you are considered as a bridge between your management and the employees. So there is no better person than you who can make that merger or acquisition really a friendly, warm, and the change manageable for people. So you look at it this way yourself, that you're comfortable here, right? You're comfortable in this city. You're probably staying here for a long time or your hometown for a long time. You've been sent somewhere else for a job. And that job could be in some difficult geography that's not really nice to you. You're not happy about it. The kind of feelings it creates for you, it makes you really uncomfortable. You don't feel like working anymore. You don't want to continue working there. So what do? You need someone who's making that transition seamless and smooth, right? And that's where HR plays a critical role. So what kind of initiatives do you take? Okay, let's design an engagement program where there is a face-off between employees of this institution and the employees of the other organization coming together, exchange of ideas, exchange of knowledge, having your, outings, taking all of them together, realigning the objectives, recreating the organization for the new set of people, giving them that warm welcome. You know, these are things that HR really needs to lead and practice. You have to be a leader from the front. You cannot be sitting at your desk and expect the CEO to come and tell you, boss, ab karna hai karo. Don't wait. Never wait for the signals. Be an initiative taker. The moment HR, I'm only talking about HR, lacks taking initiative, you're pushed to the background. Take this word from experience, as advice from the experience I've been through. You have to be leading every change from the front. Everybody else, no matter how senior the person is, going to lead you, follow you, and you have to define what comes next. So it's very important for you to be a thinker. What's going to work? Just keep thinking. You know, a problem comes to your mind, break it into milestones, each achieve every objective separately, align it, and bring it to a one final solution. Problem solving is one other very critical thing for HR. Remember that, because you have no clue what kind of problem you're going to come across. Right, so I heard somebody was saying same thing at the... Innovative training methods, again, that comes back to the point technology. It ties to the technology because, yes, you can't really have trainings like this. Okay, you need to ensure that you're able to reach your people for the skill sets and competency development using technology. Extremely important because you can't really stop training people, right? How do you develop skills? How do you develop competencies? You can't just keep hiring people. Remember, at any given point of time, I'm assuming that you guys are going to be data guys. Manpower is a cost that's going to hit. So you have to be someone who's optimizing those skills to train the people up. So let me give you an example. I think my spend for training and development last year was zero. So does that mean I did zero training and development? No. In fact, we did the maximum training last year. I utilized the entire organization to cross-train. Completed. The entire year we had almost, the number looks really unimaginable, but I had 40 trainings with a minimum of each training 8 hours. That is the training we delivered. It actually looked like the entire year we were only training. But optimum, cost-effective. These are the innovations that you need to come up with because the knowledge is sitting inside in the institution itself. First, optimize the internal knowledge, the internal experience. If my institution says that I have 400 years of experience and knowledge sitting in the institution with the leadership team, I don't see any reason I should go out. Because an outsider does not know my institution that well as much as the insider does. So this thinking, this logical approach on how to really tackle problems is important. And coming back to your point, unique, innovative training solutions is very important. So it gets partly tied up to the point of technology. The other part is important that you, for example, when you're making your training calendar. For us right now, when we have gone through theory, it clearly looks like a simple one-egg table. But now, look at what people want. Just put in the skills and competencies there and then deliver that calendar, but it's exactly the opposite. It's most difficult. In practical, I will tell you what happened is people will not know what they want their trainings to be done with. You go to any business head, they will not know. They will come up with some, one-off experience. Ye hua tha, so maybe we should give them training into that. Maybe we should train that. So that ambiguity needs to be crossed by training. You cannot really create a training calendar basis assumptions. Put in steps. Map people aspirations. Take their past experience. Look at the projects they are doing, have done in the institution. What is their performance rating on those projects been like? What do they think they would have done better? What they really did well? Create a complete, exhaustive understanding. It's huge work. It's huge amount of work. It is not simple. You have to be into it to do it. The administrative work we can do is create a table. But what goes into the table, if it needs to be defined by the HR professional, the HR professional has to work very hard to get that done. There is no point in just creating, you do your performance assessment and then we have a question asked there, what are the development areas the manager will then fill in? Development areas is, say, analytical skills, negotiation skills. Where is that coming from? You have to question the business. You have to question the managers, why do you say that? What do you think is not working out? So it's very important that you get the right stuff. Please also understand that you have a role which needs to be very balanced. While you are a lot inclined towards people and people benefits, you also have to balance and understand the business requirements. You can't just keep implementing training after training. The objective is not so many hours of training. The objective is what is the impact of the training that is given. You are no longer going to be measured that as an HR professional, you have facilitated 200 hours of training. So you might have achieved your KPI, but what is the impact of those 200 hours of training? Did you incite and excite the people to innovate? What happened after that? Did that negotiation skills really change so much that he's able to negotiate things well? What is the change that has come after the training is what your real deliverable is. What is the impact that your training solutions create in the business? That's why we say that is how HR is going to be the partner to the business. So that's the difference, in the evolving, the way the businesses are changing. More to add to this, you are obviously looking at a lot of, engagement practices that you need with the employees. So can anybody tell me which is the biggest engagement factor for an employee? I hear learning. Work-life balance, growth. Sorry? Rewards and recognition, okay. Job design, okay. Work environment, development, learning and development. So I'm happy to get all the relevant names. Salary. Decision making. So all of the points that you have really come up with is absolutely correct. But let me tell you the basic thing. Okay? So there are institutions that really are spread across the geography, right? You're working in remote places in India, out of India. So you have your rewards recognition, you have your learning and development, you are well compensated, you give all the benefits. The employee is still unhappy. What can you do? What could be the reason? Work-life balance bhi hai. You have enough bench. You can utilize as you want. You can utilize people the way you want.
Job satisfaction.
What is job satisfaction? Absolutely. So I'll just take her point and elaborate it very differently. When you take interviews and you are hiring experienced people, you ask, why are you quitting your earlier job? The lamest answer you have is job satisfaction. So you need to explain what's job satisfaction. So you're saying, I wasn't enjoying my work, but I'm offering you the same job here. So how are you going to enjoy here? It's the same thing, right? I mean, I'm hiring you because the skill set that you already have. So what different am I going to do? It's the same job you have to do. So you're quitting one company for the other company to do the same job because you didn't have a job satisfaction. So you need to ensure, be very clear about, what this job satisfaction syndrome basically is. What it really means is you have to assist the employees to evaluate if they're doing the right thing by playing the job or the role they're doing. Most likely, if they say they're not satisfied with the job, 90% of the times they are in a role that they don't want to be in. They are doing work that they are not supposed to do or they don't enjoy doing it. And that is the basic thing, you know, in the entire pyramid of HR. If you have your workforce not interested in doing what they're doing, it reflects in the work. What does it do? It then impacts the performance. Where does this performance impact? It's not about an individual performance. Every individual contributes to the overall company performance. So it impacts the company performance. So that's where another very critical piece is, you know, it's actually a very ambiguous term. I'll be very happy if a bunch of you new kids, you know, you have real high energy levels, go out and kill the word job satisfaction. Take this advice. Don't entertain that word. Not because it's not a very important thing, it's very critical, but to be able to define what this job satisfaction means is the most toughest part. Build in competencies where you're able to match. When you are hiring for a specific role, make that person go through a competency test. You do not need to spend money. You have a biggest teacher in Google. Just use that Google. There are several tests that are there. Create a test for yourself and ensure that you run that test through when you're hiring people. After 6 months, you will have the same employee. Kuch achha nahi lag raha, I don't like it, I'm not enjoying. What more can you do? You have everything, right? You're doing everything right for the company. What is it that you can do different? Only this much you can do, right? So avoid those pitfalls. Avoid these errors because these are very expensive errors. An employee leaving after a certain period of time, multiply his cost by 10. That is the spend you have done on the employee. That is how you're impacting your business. That is, you know, these are the analysis that you do will actually make you a business partner rather than an HR professional just managing the administrative side of people. If you want to secure that seat in the boardroom, if you want to sit in front of the CEO and argue, you need to reflect these capabilities to be able to take these decisions. Now, decision brings me to another point where someone really here mentioned HR is known to be a very poor decision maker. Probably a reason that these decisions most of the times lie with the unit heads or with the, you know, CEOs and CFOs, etc. But unless you exhibit the maturity to be able to take decisions, nobody's going to believe that you can take those decisions. How do you do that? Data comes into the play. So if you have to take a call, if you have to take a decision, please take it. Don't wait for people to come and tell you whether you're right or wrong. If you're wrong, you pay the price for it because you will not repeat it. Ek galti se job nahi jayega. But please inculcate the skill of decision making right now. You have to be able to take decisions, and those decisions have to be based on something. Gut nahi chalta hai, intuitions don't work. I feel, he feels, they feel doesn't work. What the market says doesn't work, but data speaks for itself. Every decision has to be backed with the data. There should never be any gray area. It's either black or it's white. When you follow that path, things will automatically fall in line. The decision making, please bind it with yourself. It's not just about, again, HR. It's for all of you generally in life. Be good decision makers. And be prepared to, if any decision, see, it's not necessary that all of us have to be right. Like, I have made mistakes in the decisions that I've taken, but I've learned from them. So mistakes have to learn, that's all. That's the only page you need to tear from the mistakes book. There's nothing else, and move on. Push that aside and move on. But it is very important. And if you come across as a professional who's not able to take decisions, then trust me, you will not land up with those plum projects. You will not land up with those plum positions. You will not land up with those plum assignments which really you are craving for and are excited to take it up. So any other points that come to your mind when it comes to the next revolutionary HR phase?
Ma'am, full-time employees to contract employees.
See, I think that's a very business decision. Okay, how does a contract employee, see, a lot also defines the culture of the company. For example, if you are a company who's on expansion spree, it doesn't make sense that you have full-time employees on your payrolls when you are yet to define your boundaries.
That time when you are on contractual, it helps because someone else is taking care of the administrative task. You just don't want that burden, that's it. I don't see any other reason, but a lot of that decision will come from what your business decides. It needs to, you know, only when you define your business scenario will you be able to either support that decision or discard it. Because there's a lot of cultural thing also that comes in this kind of hiring, whether you want people on board or you want somebody else to really, you know, take them on their own. Anything else that comes up, I think we can open up for Q&A. One thing is a very accepted point that when an employee really leaves the company, that employee doesn't leave the company, the employee is basically leaving the manager. It is said by statistics and data, 80% of the cases are because of managers. Quite frankly, there is no solution to the problem, but the solution lies in being proactive. Solution lies in identifying that problem, and that can happen only when you're spending time analyzing the trends of your employees. If I already knew that the employee, the manager in the company, shows some issues, shows some interpersonal issues, and that is going to result into, and also remember, before this one case would happen, there will be history. There is always a history to the person, whether, you know, such things have happened in the past or not. Unless you're proactive, you can't solve the problem. The solution is obviously, which is written and known to all, train up the manager. Simple. But whether he'll get trained up or not is a different issue altogether. It's called probably a personality issue. Right? So the only way to work around this is one, A, be proactive. If you have identified such people, see, many times it happens that the manager is a high performer, but is not able to get the team to deliver. You have to also retain your manager because he's delivering. See if you can create an IC roles. What are ICs? ICs are individual contributors. They cannot work with a team. They have a skill set, they have competencies, they can deliver huge numbers, but they can never work with a team. They cannot drive the results through a team. They can work alone. And you can't even lose those people because of the value they bring to the system. So all you can do is push the manager to an IC role and get another people manager in. Because anybody who is in a manager role has to be an excellent people manager. There is no doubt about it. Point two is something which I just said, be proactive. HR is always reactive. All of us who are in HR and now when you go out, you will realize, not that you want to be like that, but circumstances when you go through it are developed in such a way that you become more of a reactive person than a proactive person. But always keep that in your mind. You have to be, see, another thing that you have to be important, remember is when it comes to finance and HR, you really work like eyes and ears of the organization. So your eyes and ears also have to be that sharp and focused. You can't be going there to do a, you know, administrative role. If you really want to develop that skill, you have to be proactive. So find the solution to the problem even before it comes. History of the employee is very important. You know, a lot of that comes from how the background of the person has been in the institution, earlier institution when you're doing background verification and reference check. These questions are very relevant. How successful was the manager? What was the attrition percentage in his team? All these questions are very relevant before you hire. So when you're hiring, you're doing an intelligent, proactive hiring. You already know the issues. Yeah, and solutions will be, again, a lot business-driven, but my suggestion is any poor manager but a high performer needs to be pushed into an individual contributor role.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Just in the center. My name is Jaya. I'm from BIMM HRD HR batch. I have two questions. The first one is, what is the role of feedback mechanism in PMS in today's competitive age? Yeah. And then second question is, HR is considered to be the cost center. HR role in optimizing operational cost and delivering higher ROI. Sorry.
Thank you. I missed your name.
Jaya.
Jaya, wonderful questions. One is, let's take up the feedback. A question was relevance or importance of feedback in PMS. So I don't know, all of you must have studied, heard about bell curve? Does it exist? No and yes. The answer is no. Outside, when you go, almost 70% of companies have stopped using FR. FR is forced ranking. What is bell curve? Forced ranking. You have defined a bell. You want to ensure that the performance of the company is fit into that bell curve. Where did bell curve come from? Where did it come? Why did it come? G. It started from there, but why did they bring it? Increase productivity. Right. But at any given point of time, I think it made life very easy for 2 decades for all the HR professionals. It was exactly. It was created to manage the budgets. And it was created to manage the rewards. That is the idea of bell curve. Today, it is not an acceptable norm. FR, forced ranking, does not work outside. Companies are squashing it. We do not use. People outside do not use. Startups do not use. Companies that have spent a lot of time do not use. So what does it mean? It means that we need to take a step back from bell curve and start managing performance right in the beginning, even before you come to the point of bell curve. Okay? Now, coming back to your question, Jaya, on feedback, the bell curve is anyway out. The annual performance system is also out. You are not looking at annual performance system. It is critical. It does not get erased from your strategy. But what has been developed is frequent feedback session. It is extremely important that you are in communication with your people. Over communication, fine, no problem. Under communication will start creating problems for all of you. You are overly communicated with your team, it's still okay, manageable. Because it's very difficult to strike a balance on what to tell and what not to tell. If you're telling too much, it's fine. If you're not speaking, then you're disengaging the employee from the process, from the system. So how it needs to work is, it depends again from company to company, what they are into, the industry that they are into. But if it is a project-based kind of a company, then after every project, an assessment needs to be done. It needs to be a cyclical, continuous feedback. A feedback, again, is very mistaken to baatcheet over coffee, chai coffee. So that is not feedback. So there are various ways of feedback. You can adopt a hybrid format, which is formal and informal. Go out for team dinners, coffee shops, where you are actually talking, discussing a project, and also giving a feedback what really worked and what didn't work. But there is another one, which is a formal feedback, and that has to be done, which HR has to ensure that it gets done. So how it really works is, I can only talk about a project-based company. I don't know how really a manufacturing or other setups really work. But post every project completion, you have your complete feedback mechanism in place, which is a 360-degree feedback for one employee. It doesn't take time, believe me. It's just like 15 minutes you can finish, but you can have the discussion for 1 hour. One project lasts for 3 to 4 months. Worthwhile a time to spend with an employee. And record that feedback. Your rating mechanism, whatever it is, 1 to 5, 5 highest, 1 lowest, for whatever reasons you have your entire system in place, rate that employee and keep that aside. That's how you mark the development calendar also for that specific team member or the entire team working on the project. So feedback is very important. There is just no doubt about it. That's why I always keep telling everybody, every manager in my company, please over-communicate. I'll handle the over-communication, but under-communication, I can't fill in those blanks.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
That will actually create a problem. Your second question was,
ma'am, HR is considered to be the cost center.
cost center. So yes, we are a cost center because we directly don't get the revenue in, and that's why I keep telling you and throughout the conversation that if you want to really secure that place there, you have to show how you're contributing. So that's why I said it is now not important for us to know how many hours of training we have facilitated. Now you have to show what is the difference you have made when you imparted that training. So your contribution in terms of ROI is larger. You can't add value to it. I can't really say 240 hours of training done. I have to show the improvement in that person or in that team or the entire employee set. So that's the value you can bring to the table. So this discussion of HR being a cost center has been going on for ages. I think Dr. T.V. Rao also must have spoken about it n number of times. But I think every HR professional needs to define that, right? So for example, when the attrition is at the peak, if you see in the industry that we are in, the attrition is really high. And in our attrition was even higher. So I think the value that HR brings to the table is how have you cut short that attrition? What is your retention levels now? What are the interventions you have taken? How are you defining the culture of the company? How happy are your people? You know, you always can do your ESATs, the employee satisfaction. Your performance can be evaluated. What is the e-satisfaction index that is allocated to you? You have to get that satisfaction levels up. So today employees say we are 40% happy. What is it that's lacking? You change that. Next cycle of ESAT, if your satisfaction level increases to 70%, that's your value added. Yeah? To reach to the level of not being a cost center, there is a lot that HR has to do. Those dynamics are completely different. Hiring cost measures, training cost measures, you have to show how you have really turned around things also by not spending money. There are times when HR has no budget. But that doesn't mean that we sit in our cabin and not do anything. You have to keep innovating and doing cost-effective things. That's where the value really comes from. Yeah?
Good evening, ma'am. Ma'am, here.
Where? Hi, sorry.
Ma'am, I want to ask you that there are several external factors which are very much uncontrollable for an organization for keeping their business with pace. So I want to ask you, as an HR person, what are the plans that we should make or what are the steps we should follow in order to cope up with those challenges that are sudden?
So just come back again, you're defining that business is going through change.
Yeah, I'm saying that, ma'am, since today's scenario is like everything is changing pretty fast.
Absolutely.
So there are more than the internal factors, there are several external factors that is impacting the business.
Right.
So as HR person, how should we plan in order to cope up with all those challenges that are very sudden? And
your name is?
My name is Utpala Ghosh.
Utpala.
Yeah.
So Utpala, I think the answer to that question rises in your question itself. If you are absolutely involved as a person, I'm not saying individual, but as an HR professional in the business strategy, you will know. See, if you're sitting insulated and isolated from your business dynamics, you will not know. And that's why I keep saying be a business partner and don't be an HR professional. So unless you don't know how the external factors are going to influence the organization, you will not be able to plan. So let's take an example. Any example that comes to your mind now, any change, any business house that's going through a change? Brexit has happened. Oh, that's a wonderful example. Are we all glued in on what's happening on the Brexit?
Yes.
And have you also seen how it is going to impact the Indian IT space, what is being said? So what should we do? Let's say we are HR professionals servicing a huge IT conglomerate which is going to get hugely impacted with the Brexit move. So what are the next steps? Let's say that we are one team in one company, we have to develop a strategy. So what is the objective? First thing, always remember when you're creating a strategy, create an objective. First is objective. When your objective is very clear in front of you, the other things will fall in line. So our objective is the IT industry is going to be impacted. It is possible that our company will be impacted, which means that there will probably be a slowdown in our business, which means that we may have to retrench, right? One of the possibilities, accepted everybody? So what do we need to do? You need to play the avatar of a change manager. People will start panicking. Everybody's heard about Brexit. Everybody's heard about the after effects. Everybody knows what can happen. So all the employees will know that there is a possibility that we might tell them to leave. But there may be a chance that our business leaders have come up with a business possibility that we might not have to ask people to leave. We have a different game plan. How do you control the uncontrolled attrition that will happen here forward? Please be over-communicative. Have town halls. Most important thing is your senior leadership, your management has to be very closely in touch with the people. You don't have to people to go to them frequently. They should not break the hierarchies. That is not the intention. But these ambiguities and doubts can be squashed only by the head of your organization, who is submitting very clearly what the game plan or strategy for the organization is. You have to be upfront and honest. See, I know this is happening. My institution is going to be shaken a little, but I have a plan. This is what my plan is. We don't have to worry. We are fine. And these need to be a very frequent town hall. Your disengagement levels from employee will be very evident. Your managers have to be very alert. They have to immediately come to you or to their supervisor and say, look, there's a problem. There's some drop in the performance. There's some issue. He's absenting very frequently. He's taking half days very frequently. These are very subtle messages. These are disengagement messages. And you have to, again, like I said, one of the individuals earlier, be very proactive. Again, what else can you do? Create other engagement platforms. Now, if that is one piece which is impacting, why not call a complete knowledge sharing session on Brexit? Let the people take it. Let them talk. And when they talk more about the problem, it occurs to them that there probably is a solution. You're more embracing the issue. You can't really solve the challenge. It's not in your control. It's beyond your control. What you can do is discuss it. And post-discussion, what will be bring to your notice is, what are they struggling with? People, when you sit in front of each other and ask, what is the problem you have, they'll never tell you. It will never come out. They will never discuss that openly. But when you put them in a room and say, now talk, you will actually be able to come up with a list of problems that they really have. Address all of them. Have to have an open communication channel. Every institution today has a corporate communication team. Use that corporate communication team to inform everything that's happening. Anything that, any legal battle the company is fighting, any other allegation the company has been, everyone has to know, because they're stakeholders. They are co-creators in your business. If you treat employees as equal, only then they will get that sense of responsibility and respect. If you treat them like an employee or a laborer, they will work like that. If you create an opportunity for them and make them look like a co-creator of the organization, they will work double the responsibility. So just take those steps. I think it's a very open-ended question, but if you have any case study, come up. I'll share my mail IDs. We can discuss that.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I'm an Adi Rivedi from BITM marketing batch. My question is, as you had told earlier about the merging and acquisitions, when one larger business acquires the smaller firms, what are the challenges faced by the employees of the smaller organization in that new environment during this merging process?
So it's just like this. Take yourself, you can actually create an analogy that if you are, you live with your family, right? And all of a sudden for exams, for some other purpose, you have to go away from there and stay somewhere else. You have a different comfort level in your organization where you're working. When the merger happens, you are going to start interfacing with a different set of individuals altogether. It is obvious discomfort at level one. Discomfort is more from personal and mental. The second stage that really comes is ambiguity. Because every acquisition, every merger creates one major problem, duplication of role and duplication of responsibility. Which means, why do you acquire or why do you merge? There are synergies between those companies. Either the businesses are simple or the new business will augment the existing business or support the purpose of business expansion. The most premise is synergy. They are a similar business. Two mobile tech companies coming together, two IT companies coming together. They're working on the same platform, same products. That increases the profit market share for everybody. But what ambiguity it creates is that there, as against where there were
10 software developers needed. Now you have 15. So you have a bench of 5. Can you really have that bench of 5? What do you do with those 5 members? So those 5 members, whoever they are, out of those 10 plus 5, will be in constant ambiguity, thinking whether their jobs are secure or will they be asked to leave because there's additional staff. So the role of HR, again, in the situations like I addressed, because this is one of the biggest challenges that HR has, is to do a very closely family mapping, job family mapping. So I don't know if you all must have gone through a theory where how compensation surveys are done. Similarly, you need to do a job family mapping. What is job family is, let's say, software developer. I'm just taking a tech because it's a little easier for us to understand. Within that software developer, there will be various job roles. One will be, I think, a quality guy. One will be probably a tester. One will be a developer. Another developer will be much better than this guy. There will be levels. And probably by creating that job family, you will have 7 levels of jobs. For those 7 levels of jobs, you have 15 people. On an average per job family, you have 2. So the ratio is 1:2. So is 1:2 is the ratio that your organization really wants? Once you are done with those kind of, because you will probably have multiple job families to do, only then will you be able to justify that we probably don't have to retrench anyone, or the people who have to really go is a very minimal risk. Before the merger or acquisition really happens, the HR, whoever is on the either side, have to engage with both the companies. There have to be several engagement programs that have to happen. They have to walk through the cultural change that will happen. They are working differently. They work here differently. Some other place, it is a 9-to-5 job. Here it is, you can work from home. There's no control. You work at night, you work at morning, work from a coffee shop. There's a huge cultural difference. Adjustment is a big issue. Some people are used to working from the Some people work really well from home. The IT space also seeing a lot of revolution where they are not restricting some very rigid rules. So what is very important here is the agility. How do you create that agility? If they are used to working 9-to-5, no problem. You don't have to change it overnight, right? There is one section of the company that will work 9-to-5. That will work like that for some time till they settle down. Eventually, the change and transition happens. If you try to enforce your culture on them, or they try to enforce their culture on you, that is going to create huge challenge. So there has to be a balance. What is acceptable, what is not acceptable. And one thing in our minds, we have to accept that people will move on. That anxiety at some point of time really takes a better of your mental case, quite frankly. So those things will happen, unavoidable, but what you can do is to control that by being proactive right in the beginning. So when your business informs you, we're going to merge or we're going to acquire, take a leadership position and say, I would like to go and meet the people there. Whoever is the HR spoke, have discussions. Define your timelines. You are as important as the CFO or the CEO. I will not let the merger happen until 2 weeks, until 2 months. You want to do your transaction paperwork and be done, but people will take 1 month. People will take 2 months. People merger will take that kind of time. Place your paper, place your objectives, define the role that you have to do there. So challenges are more on psychological level than anything on the other side, because most of the mergers and acquisition have always seen retrenchment. But if there is better planning, you have solutions to it. You have to work with your businesses very closely to create solutions for people. A newest form of HR is, again, when you are landing up in a situation where you have to downsize your company, work as an exit manager, where you are openly sharing opportunities with those people, finding jobs for them, giving them links for job, coordinating with a placement agency, making them meet the placement guy, finding jobs for them. So that comfort is important. Always remember, exit is the most important thing in HR. How smoothly you make an employee leave the organization is what you will be credited for. Because they are your brand ambassadors. The one who is entering in will always have a good experience because you will ensure that you are doing really good for people who are coming in. The one who is leaving is very important. Most important, rather. So come up with some very innovative ways of managing this issue. Broadly, it is a business decision whether you can take that cost or no. But if that's not working out, create some other solutions as an HR professional.
Madam, Hello? I have a question. Here. Madam, I'm here only. Here, here.
Sorry.
I have a question. See, madam, yeah? In your presentation, you were saying that your organization is in two different continents, Africa as well as in India, and you have plans to expand further. Now, in the office, you were saying you are a frequent visitor to Nairobi. My question is, as an HR professional, if you see in my auditorium, 50% of students are females.
Right.
Now, you have some of the experience, some of the challenges you faced in this kind of experience. If you can share, it would be nice.
Sure. So, I think how HR is really perceived broadly, a lot of organizations are of belief that women really make good managers. And that is not really a statement that comes way off, but I think simply from a fact that women can multi-hat in their responsibilities in personal space also comes to fore when it comes to jobs. So challenges are there. There's no denying, but I think what really, really works here is your objective. I mean, that's something that I've been trying to tell you right from beginning. You have to be willing to do it yourself. For example, when I was working in one of my assignments, which was a hospitality company, and they obviously did travel, air travel, hotels, and leisure, and everything. Now, to understand that industry, really, I actually went through the complete operations training. I did a course on how the airlines book the tickets. How does an airline really work? How does an aircraft work? All of that. And that was almost almost a 10-day training that I went through. There was no need. The trainers were really surprised to see an HR person sitting there. I insisted that I want to sit. That's only because I wanted to understand. So I can't really go up to a person working out there and say, you know, you're not really doing your job effectively unless I understand what is the issue there. What is the problem that the person is facing? So I think the only way to overcome challenges is to embrace it. And frankly, accept that debt will be there. So it's not just necessary that things are going to be really easy. It just gets tougher and tougher, but you have to keep going forward. For example, I have a small child, and traveling is quite an issue. Children are very attached to their parents, but I had to do that. I had to travel. I've been to Nairobi for about 3 times now, and I think she was 3 years old then. And that's for the first time when I went, and I was extremely scared. I don't know how she was going to deal with it. She coped. She did really well. She didn't even cry once. So I think there are several such challenges that will really come, personal, professional, but you have to have the willpower to overcome it and to endure it. There is no two ways. And especially women, because I think in the country that we are and the societies that we live in, there's a lot of positive things happening for women. There's no doubt. We are being empowered. We are taking leadership positions in a lot of corporates. We are taking leadership position in politics. So we are there everywhere, but you can't really forget that culturally we are a nation where there are challenges for this gender. There's no choice. But I think if you have decided that you have to make it, then break all the barriers. You have to find solutions. You have to go for it. You have to be tough, personally, in your mind, professionally. You have to take tough decisions and move on. And obviously, a lot of it is driven by your priorities. I'm not saying really put a curtain on your personal life, but take a balanced decision.
Thank you, ma'am. Your views on a wide range of contemporary issues, be it importance of financial inclusion, institution challenges, HR as a change manager, or importance of engagement program are the takeaways from your session, and it will definitely help us in our corporate career.